पवित्रवतु।
Dear friends, good afternoon to everyone. And today I am going to speak to you on the special theory of relativity. Up to 18th century, Newton was considered as the great scientist in the world, and he has given his laws, his rules, his equations, and they were considered very true. Nobody was able to challenge the Newton's laws, and they were considered the Newton's laws also was applicable to the macroscopic bodies. Macroscopic means the big bodies, and there are small body physics that is known as a microscopic, that is small particle. Of course, Newton has given some view about the microscopic bodies, and he has given the particle theory, corpuscular theory, particle nature of the light. And this particle nature of the light, he said that the particle, light is a form of a particle. And the color of the light is because of the different size of the particle. And he said that light is a particle. In the 1805, the interference has come in the picture, and Thomas, young Thomas, has given an experiment of the two slits, and he had made the two slits and a source of light here. He found that the interference pattern is formed on this. And this particular experiment distorted the particle theory of the Newton. Whatever Newton says that light is a particle nature, and the different size of particles, that is discarded. In 1864, the Maxwell, Clark Maxwell, has given the four Maxwell's equation of electromagnetic field. These Maxwell's equations of electromagnetic field are nothing but they are the relation between the electric and magnetic vectors. He said that electric vector can be equal to the magnetic vector. All the four equations are based on that. Electric and magnetic vectors are correlated. They are not two different things. Again, this predicts that existence of the electromagnetic wave. So we will say now, light is not a particle nature, it is a wave nature. Earlier it was considered like particle nature, now it is a wave nature. In the 1887, electromagnetic radio waves were discovered, and again they say that light is not a particle, it is a wave, and it is an electromagnetic wave. So this was verified by the Hertz, that light is electromagnetic waves, and it is verified by the up to 19th century, the physicists believed that all types of waves need a medium. It's similar to the sound wave. Sound wave needs a medium. Sound cannot propagate in the vacuum. So similarly, the light also should need a medium. So this was the thinking up to 19th century, that light should have a medium, because light is a wave. So it should, when it goes from one place to another, it should have a medium. For that purpose, however, we know that light is also propagating in the vacuum. vacuum also the light moves. When we say light propagates in the vacuum nothing is there. Vacuum means nothing is there, but light propagates. Sound does not propagate in the vacuum, light propagates. So, physicists, to explain this, that light is propagating in the vacuum, physicists, scientists that time, particularly Huygens and others, they consider there is some medium, and that medium is called ether, which is a weightless, there is no weight of that. It is spread all over, it is odorless, there is no smell of that medium, it is a colorless, and it is a perfectly elastic medium is that ether, and it is spread all over universe, and light, for propagation of light, this medium is required. In that case, the speed of light should change now with the respect to ether. As the sound speed is changing with the motion of the medium, similarly the light speed also should change with the flow of the medium or velocity of the medium. Experiments were performed and compared the speed of light along with the and against. Now the thing comes in the mind that light, sound propagates at a speed of 330 meters per second, that is not very large, but light propagates at a speed of 3 into 10 to the power 8 meters, 3 lakhs kilometers per hour. So the medium speed should be comparable to that.
Per second.
So the medium speed should be of that order. Then only the effect can be seen. So therefore, to see the effect, Michelson and Morley, they try to do this, and in this case they have done experiment considering the earth is revolving around a sun with a speed of 30 kilometers per second. Sound, earth is moving with a speed of 30 kilometers per second. This 30 kilometers per second can be considered comparable to the velocity of light. So, in this Michelson-Morley experiment, he considered that earth is moving, so there must be some direction in which the ether is there, or ether is going in backward, it is fixed and earth is moving. So he has sent the light waves, one along the direction of the ether, another is a perpendicular to the direction of ether. These are the Michelson and Morley. One thing I want to tell you here, it is a combination of physicist and chemist. Michelson was a physicist and Morley was a chemist, person of chemistry. And they have got the Nobel Prize in 1907. So the experiment is like this. There is a source of light here. There is a beam splitter. Then there are two perpendicular mirrors, mirror two. Two perpendicular mirrors are there, and mirrors are mirror three and mirror two. Source of light, this is your beam splitter and screen on which you can see the interference fringes. The light is propagating, sent in the on the beam splitter. And let us consider this is the velocity of the earth, that is the velocity of the ether, we can say. So the beam 1 to 2 is going along the direction of the velocity of ether, 1 to 2. While, so the what will be the velocity when the beam is going from 1 to 2, it will be C plus V, where C is the velocity of light and V is the velocity of the ether. And when it is returning, reflected back and returning from 2 to 1, it will be C minus V. V is the velocity of the earth. Is it alright? Therefore, we can calculate if d is the distance between the mirror and beam splitter, then the round trip time for this is will be t1 to 1. Light going from the beam splitter to mirror and returning back, that will be the distance is 2d upon c into 1 minus v square upon c square. That you can calculate by just 2 minutes. We can get this out. And now we take in this way that light is sent from 1 to 3. From 1 to 3. Another mirror. They are equally distance. Distance is same. So the velocity in that case will be equal to c square minus v square, because the v is the velocity. You can make a diagram of the velocity. So you can make a diagram like this. This way. So perpendicular direction velocity will be this way.
Yes.
And in that case, you can, if you calculate the round trip time, it will be coming t1 3 1, and that will come equal to 2d upon c 1 minus half v square upon c square.
After binomial expansion.
When we solve it, it comes equal to this. So therefore, the difference in that two times comes out to be t1 to 1. Like this, this way is going and returning, and 1 to 3 going and returning, it comes out to be d into v square upon c cube. That mathematics, you can solve it, you can get. If this is the time difference between the two rays, therefore corresponding path difference will be multiplied by d, divided by c, multiplied by c, so it will come equal to d into v square upon c square. And for the interference fringes, it should be equal to n lambda, path difference equal to n lambda for maxima. If I consider n lambda equal to 5000 and d equal to 10 meters, then this particular calculation gives me the n equal to 0.2 fringe. There should be a shift of 0.2 fringe in that case. And this apparatus which they have made was very accurate, and its accuracy was up to 0.01 fringe. Further, if I rotate the apparatus by 180 degree, then the fringe shift should come equal to 0.4, 0.2 plus 0.2. If we make a rotation complete 180 degree, then the ray which was going against the ether will be the direction of ether and perpendicular direction as it is. So the velocity will be double, and therefore there will be a fringe shift of the 0.4. But however, to surprise of everyone, there was no fringe shift obtained. There was no fringe shift was obtained. So this Michelson model experiment is the negative result has come. So repeated at the various places, various times, with a very accurate and precise speed, but all the time the result was negative. The result was negative all the time, where no fringe shift was seen. And once we say that there is no fringe shift, means this is a blow to the ether hypothesis. that is exist in time. However, with the Huygens theory of the light and the ether imagination was very much strongly fit in the minds of the scientists that there is an ether. But this experiment shows there is no ether. Then they give the various excuses, and one of the excuses was given by the Lorentz, and he said that the length of the apparatus is reduced, contracted in the direction of the velocity. So that shrinks, it reduces in the direction of the velocity. But however, this is given, but no theoretical proof was available for this reduction in the length. He said that length is reduced in the direction of the velocity, so therefore there is no frame shift. The shrink, whatever that comes, that is equal to this. The reduced length is this much. But for this, there is no theoretical proof. We cannot say that its direction will chota ho jayega, its direction will rakhenge, it becomes infinite. So there is no theoretical proof available. Then again, some people they try that ether is dragged with the earth, so there is no friendship. The velocity of light, earth is there, and the ether is also moving along the velocity of the earth, so there is no friendship. But if we see the aberration of light means if you want to see a star at the azimuth vertically up, you will find that the a star which you see, you cannot keep the telescope vertically up. You have to slant it at a certain direction, and this slanting you have to go on rotating at 360 degrees all the time throughout the year. So therefore the ether drag hypothesis is again ruled out. Then in 1905, about 109 years back, Albert Einstein has given the theory of relativity, a special theory of relativity, and this special theory of relativity is based on two postulates. He assumed the two things. First thing, he assumed that the laws of physics are equally valid in all inertial frames. Here I want to tell any frame which is having a uniform or constant velocity will be an inertial frame. Either stationary or moving with a constant velocity will be inertial frame. And second postulate which he has taken is that speed of light in free space C is same for all the frame of reference, whether it is moving or it is stationary, the speed of light will be same for all frame of reference. Therefore, he said that C plus V, V is the velocity of the frame, C is the velocity of light, will be the observed C only. And C minus V, any velocity subtracted from velocity of light will be equal to velocity of light. On the basis of these two postulates, these two things, mathematician Lorentz was a mathematician and Einstein was a physicist. And these two has come together and they have given the transformation. Now what should be the transformation equation? If we consider velocity of light is same in all the frame, and we consider that the law of physics will be same for all the inertial frame of reference. So we consider that there are two frame of reference, one is y and y dash. there are two frame of reference. One is shown by the black line, another by the blue line. The blue line frame of reference is moving with a velocity v. Moving with a velocity v along a positive x direction.
Moving with a constant velocity.
Constant velocity. It is moving with a constant velocity v. It is an inertial frame, but they are moving. Then he said that the transformation equation should be equal to x dash equal to alpha, alpha is some constant, x minus vt. The classical transformation equation is x minus vt. So he has multiplied by alpha, and if the equation remains same, the value of alpha may come equal to 1. So he said that it will be nice. And as there is no velocity in the y direction, so y dash will be equal to y and z dash will be equal to z. This is by the first postulate of the
speed of light is same.
And second postulate says that the speed of light is constant for all the frame of reference. Therefore, c into t square is equal to x square plus y square plus z square. The distance traveled equal to c into t. On the other side, in the other frames, c into t dash square, please make it t dash square equal to x dash square plus y dash square plus z dash square. On solving these two equations for determining the relation between the x and x dash and t dash, we obtained the equation x dash equal to x minus vt upon square root of 1 minus v square upon c square. Y dash has remained same, there is no velocity in the y direction, and z dash remains same as there is no velocity in the z direction. But surprisingly, it comes that t is not same as a t dash. The time does not come equal to the t dash in the time in the one frame is equal to the time in other frame minus x into v upon c square divided by square root of 1 minus v square upon c square. These are known as the Lorentz transformation equations for space and time. Looking at these equations, one interesting thing we can see that space is a x or x dash is cohesively very much related to the time. You cannot say that the space is independent quantity and time is a independent quantity. Space and time, they are cohesively, they depend on each other. They are cohesively related. Here is a distance, here is a time, here is a time, here is a space. So space and time, they are not two independent quantity, they will be depending
on each other. Yeah.
Or they are correlated, cohesively related to each other. If we want to get an inverse, the prime terms should come on the right hand side and unprime terms to come on the left hand side. We get the inverse Lorentz transformation equations like this. And this inverse Lorentz transformation equations, you can get just by putting the sign of u, changing the sign of u or v plus to minus. Only that much you do, so you will get inverse Lorentz transformation. Now if we consider these equations and we observe the length of any object in from the two frame of reference, from the two different frame of reference, one is stationary, other one is moving. So let us say that my one frame of reference is x dash, which is moving frame, and x is my stationary frame. Then x1 dash is a coordinate of the one point of the length. You can say that x1 dash is this point. I want to measure this length. X1, X2, we want to measure this length. Then I can write by the Lorentz transformation of space and time that x1 dash equal to x1 minus vt upon 1 square root of 1 minus v square upon c square, and x2 dash equal to x2 minus vt upon square root of 1 minus v square upon c square. Therefore, the length which will be x2 dash minus x1 dash is a delta x, length of the body in a moving frame, is equal to x2 minus x1 upon square root of 1 minus v square upon c square. X2 minus x1 is a delta x, the length. Therefore, delta x and delta x dash. Delta x dash is a moving length and delta x is the length which is at the station. So, if a car is moving, its length is a 2 meters, then a moving person in the car or a person sitting in the car having a meter scale, that will say that it is 1 meter. But the person looking from the outside on the road will say no, it is not 1 meter, it will be less. A meter scale is kept in the car, so the length of meter scale inside the person on the car will say it is a 1 meter, but outside person when it measures, its length comes out to be less
than 1 meter.
Again, here I want to tell that this is a relative thing. If a car is moving for a frame of reference of Earth, the car is a moving point. On the other side, from the car frame of reference, the Earth is moving. The observer on the road is moving backward. So it is a relative thing. On the other side also, this will be the same thing. Another example I want to give about this, that suppose a train and platform, they are of equal length. Let us say they are equal length, whatever the length of the platform is there, same is the length of the train. When they are stationary, they are equal. But when the train comes moving with a velocity, high velocity, and there is an observer on the roof of the train, so that he can see both the sides of the end of the train and platform. And there is an observer on the platform. The observer on the platform is the frame of reference, his frame of reference is stationary. He will observe the train is smaller. Length of the train is smaller and length of the platform is bigger. On the other side, the observer on the roof of the train or in the train will observe that no, it is wrong. The length of the train is bigger and length of the platform is shorter. This is a comparative thing. So both the things are correct according to the relativity. So we can say it is depending upon the observer. If I consider there is a sphere, there is a sphere when its velocity is zero. When it starts moving and we are observing from the Earth, then if its velocity equal to 0.3c, it will look like this. When its velocity is 0.6c, it will look like this. It becomes ellipsoid. When its velocity is 0.9c, it will look like this. In the vertical direction, there is no change, but on the horizontal direction, it will be shortening. As the velocity goes on increasing, it will be shortening. Another constant of this relativity is that time dilation. This time which we observe is not an absolute quantity. It depends upon the two observers. In the classical physics, we always say that time is same for you and other person. A clock, if it is 1 hour of the clock, for you also same, and for a person moving in with a certain velocity, it will be same. Clock, 1 hour will be 1 hour to you and 1 hour. But in the special theory of relativity, if I consider, then the time has not remained same. Let us say that there are two clocks which are synchronized, which are same, identical clocks are there. So they will show kept side by side, they will show the same time, 1 hour in one clock, 1 hour in the other clock also. But if one clock is moving and other clock is at rest, then moving clock will go slow down, go slow down. Its time will be less, more. Moving clock will show more time. 1 hour of a stationary clock, suppose I am observing and moving clock is there, so 1 hour of my stationary clock and 1 hour of other's stationary clock will be much bigger, more than that. And that is known as time dilation. About this time dilation, I want to tell one story of the twin paradox. Suppose there is a twin, two persons of the same age, and they are there. And then one person decides to go on a round trip to a long distance. He goes in a rocket and with a very large velocity comparable to the velocity of light and returns back. He will find that the person on the earth will say, for me it is a 80 years time and for him it is a 20 years time. He will be 20 years old and he will be 80 years old. On the other side, if I take in other way, it will be just reverse. The person in the born in the rocket will say, no, no, for me it is a 20 years and person on the earth it is a 80 years. Because the both the clocks are moving, other clock is moving slow. So he will say, now I have passed 80 years. He will say, no, you have passed only 20 years. So this is a twin paradox we call. For this we consider that time t dash is Lorentz transformation of time is this. Let us consider it the same place the things are happening. So t2 dash minus t1 dash is a delta t dash. That is a time in one frame of reference. And we write the Lorentz transformation, then we can see that this is the t2 dash and this is my t1 dash, and this difference will be equal to delta t upon this.
So the factor root of 1 minus this reference is,
and then this factor 1 square root of 1 minus v square upon c square comes. And this clearly indicates that delta t dash is more and delta t is smaller. Because square root of 1 minus v square upon c square is always less than 1. It is always less than 1. So therefore it comes like this. So the time. Now the time which is observed in the stationary frame is known as a proper time. So this will be my proper time. Delta t is my proper time and that is the observed time. So observed time is always greater than the proper time, and this is known as a time dilation. Second thing which we want to tell, that relativity of simultaneity. Now two events are simultaneous in one frame of reference. For example, I take, suppose we are sitting in a classroom. I switch on the lamp and lamp glows at some other place. Switch is here, lamp is there. These two things, as soon as you switch on, lamp glows, and they are simultaneous. But these two things, when it is absorbed from a moving frame, they will not be simultaneous. Now the two events in my frame is a T, one is a T1 and T2. So these are the two events. And when I consider, this will be equal to, at the different place, lamp is at one place and
switch
at other place. So X2 dash is the lamp position, X1 dash is the switch position. Then I find that T2 minus T1, on this side there is a time. On this side it is the space. There is no time factor here. So the events which are simultaneous, suppose T2 minus T1 is 0, you will say simultaneous, but this will not be 0. This will not be 0 because x2 minus x1 is having some quantity somewhere and it will not be.
But it will tend to 0.
Huh?
It will tend to 0.
Tend to 0 depending upon the speed. Required is very large.
So your view. Speed.
Speed. If the speed is small, then it will be almost close to the 0. Now, the velocity transformation. This velocity transformation also we can obtain easily by differentiating the
space
Lorentz transformation of space. And you can get the relation like this. And u y this, because the u y dash is same, but in the u y velocity, because dt will be changing, so you will get here that quantity. Time will be different. Y dash is same as y, but u dash will not be same as u dash. And z dash, u z dash will not be same as u z. Another thing which I want to tell here. This u y dash is depending upon u x dash.
Even the u z is depending upon the
u. And u z is depending upon u x dash. So if there is no velocity in one direction, you may get the velocity in the other direction.
If u x is 0, then u z is same as u z.
Then it will be 0. U z will be same as u x. Another thing which you can try easily, if you consider that the velocity of light, anything added to the velocity of light is equal to the velocity of light. I give you one problem. You consider this is the ux is the velocity of light. You take c minus v or plus v, whatever you want to do, upon 1 minus c into v upon c square and solve it. You will get equal to c. If you write, you can try it. Put u x equal to c and solve it. You will get the answer c plus v or c minus v equal to c. It comes out
c.
So therefore, what we said earlier in the second postulate, the anything added to the velocity of light is the velocity of light, or anything subtracted from the velocity of light is equal to velocity of light, and that comes here. Now, little mechanics also we will not. In the mechanics, Newtonian mechanics is applicable. If v is very, very smaller than c, if v is very, very smaller than c, all the laws are there. And in the mechanics, the most important law is the law of conservation of momentum. Law of conservation of momentum. This momentum is given by P equal to M into V. Now, as velocity is changing with frame to frame, as velocity is changing from frame to frame, and momentum I want same, we want same momentum, velocity is changing from frame to frame.
So
therefore, mass must change from frame to frame. And this mass transformation is given by this relation. If I see this relation and if I consider that M0 is a certain value but U is going on increasing, the M goes on increasing. And that's why the mass of the body start becoming more and more. Mass of the body becomes more and more. And therefore, it is impossible, because when U reaches equal to C, the mass becomes infinite, and infinite mass means no force can move. So it is impossible to accelerate any body equal to the velocity of light. When the velocity of the object approaches the speed of light, its mass approaches infinity and an object becomes impossible. And therefore, we can say that the velocity of light is the upper limit for any object to have. No object can have a velocity more than the velocity of light. That is the maximum limit. Therefore, I can write that momentum equal to gamma. Gamma is nothing but the square root of 1 minus v square upon c square. M0 is the rest mass into v. And if gamma is equal to 1, means u is very, very smaller than c, then that gamma becomes equal to 1 and this becomes a classical relation. Now here another thing which I want to tell in the relativity, and that interesting point is that E square equal to M0 square C2 to the power 4 is equal to M square C square minus this will and so on, and you will get the relation E square equal to P square C square plus M0 square C to the power 4. If I make a right angle triangle of this,
so M0 square C square and here would be P square C square and here it would be
H square
C square.
This clearly indicates if I take this triangle, then we find that rest mass energy, that is M0 C square, and momentum, C square is a constant, so momentum, they are in a perpendicular direction, they are totally independent quantity. Two perpendicular quantities are independent. Now, another thing which I want to tell, that energy. This energy which we have considered in classical physics, we said that there are two laws. One is the law of conservation of momentum and another is the law of conservation of energy in classical physics, in Newtonian physics. But here we find in relativity, when we derive the relation between the mass and energy, the energy is very much related to mass. A mass can be converted into energy and energy can be converted into mass. So therefore, we can say that mass and energy relation is there. And this mass-energy relation is very important relation for the relativity, because all the atom bomb, all the nuclear energy sources, reactors, they are based on this, that mass-energy relation. All nuclear reactors, they are consuming the, they are burning the fuels, are converting and that is converted into energy. So mass is converted into energy. And here I want to tell one thing. 1 gram of mass, as C square is very large, C square will be 9 into 10 to the power 16. This is a quite large quantity. So even I take 1 gram of mass and convert into energy, this energy will be so much that will come equal to 9 into 10 to the power 13 joules. 10 to the power 13 joules, 1 gram mass will be energy that much. And this 9 into 10 to the power 13 joules energy is a so big quantity or so enough that it can supply electricity to entire Mumbai Shahar, Mumbai,
yes,
for one day. So 1 gram is, you can burn and convert into the energy that will be equal to all the things, running the local train and whatever energy is required. That much electrical energy you can get by 1 gram, converting that 1 gram entire into the 1 gram mass into energy. Thank you. Any question now?
Sir, why is this theory known as the special theory of relativity?
Huh?
Why is the theory known as special theory of relativity?
Because later on Einstein has given one more theory, that is the general theory of relativity, which was for the accelerated frame also. This is only for the inertial frame, not accelerated frame. So it is known as a special theory of relativity. Any other question?
So, the significance of E equal to mg square formula, does it mean that a mass, when it moves with a certain velocity, if the velocity increases, it keeps on radiating energy. If the mass moves with the velocity of square of speed of light, then it will be completely converted into energy. Does it mean that?
No. The mass can be converted into energy.
When?
That is under process nuclear reaction like this. They convert the mass into energy.
So it doesn't mean that.
Another example of this mass energy relation is that binding energy of the atom. In atom, in the nucleus, you will see that all the protons are having positive charge and they remain together in the nucleus. Why they remain in the nucleus? They should repel each other, but they remain in the nucleus because of that. The mass, that certain mass of the neutron plus proton is more than the mass of the nucleus. And that whatever difference in mass is there, that is energy, is a binding energy. So they remain. Automatically, when the atom or nucleus is formed, they are there. And as soon as the nucleus is broken, their mass increases. They become proton and neutron.